It's Don Slime back on your TV. That's right. I'm downtown now. Downtown Eugene.
I'm a sucker for you.
I need a bigger joint. If anybody nearby can help me out. They left the opening for me in front of Lucky's, but I didn't park there because I don't want... It's a very, very choice parking spot. But somebody else should park there. I just need a minute to gather myself. So, I did not play saxophone tonight. If you tuned in to watch me play saxophone, well, you might not have even tuned in. I don't know how you're catching me, but I'm Uber Dyke on Periscope TV, and I've had my feed hijacked or blocked or something. I haven't been able to access it in about 2 weeks, and when I emailed Periscope TV, they told me it was because I had violated Twitter rules, which about 8 months ago apparently specifically have violated a spam rule to do with Twitter, because I post videos, and the videos are things that I do, and I don't really consider them spam. I try not to have them smell like salty meat products, but you never know. So I all of a sudden got that blocked, and it was coincidentally at the start of a new year. It's the third Periscope TV channel that I've had, and every year it gets blocked from me. And so I'm kind of done with Periscope TV, and literally I have to get a different phone, like a new phone number, to be able to have a new channel on there, unless somebody finds my Periscope account for me and gives it back to me. That could happen. I have to go through a number of steps, but the deal is that I had to have a tooth yanked yesterday, not because I don't take good care of my teeth, but because I got drug out of my car in the middle of the night when I was sleeping homeless in it last year, and beat up, and I don't know if people like actually thought that it was for a movie, or if that's just what they told people when they got caught, or what happened, but some of them were people that I play music with, and they were dressed like police officers, and they whacked me in the face, and I've had some problems with my teeth on that side up here ever since, and my jaw. I have TMJ, so and then something was in my gums, like last year, all of a sudden I had a perfectly beautiful molar back here, no problem at all, had like a big hole in it, like it had been drilled, and eventually a couple of pieces of teeth started to crack. I went to try to get help, and it wasn't covered, and all sorts of things. When you're poor, you don't get your teeth fixed because it's really expensive. And so I did what I could, and then I had a LCC dental clinic assigned, which is the local community college place where they learn to work with teeth, and they take a long fucking time. It takes a long time to get your teeth serviced there. And so normally I wouldn't be needing to have a tooth yanked, and I would have had a crown, and I would have had all sorts of things, but I couldn't afford one then. And in the meantime, like a big old hunk of It was kind of like oblong, teardrop-shaped metal came out of my gums when I was eating at TJ's, a restaurant in Crestwell, Oregon, a little bit ago, and I hope somebody grabbed it, but I'm kind of worried that it's something that could be really dangerous, because it looked kind of like a rock or like a something you would find at a hippie fair that you would buy on a table. But I think that it's like either, I think there's some pretty interesting equipment all up in there, and I would be really careful with it. So, if it was put, it wasn't, it's not part of a filling, it was way too large. It's not anything, I'm not a dentist, but it's nothing, it's not any type of a metal that I've ever seen actually before, ever. And it's not an imitation of a type of anything, and it's very, I think you should, if you know where it is, you should be careful with it. And I definitely think it shouldn't be taken into a plane, like up in where there's air pressure. So, I don't know exactly what that means, but after that came out of my, gums, it felt a lot better in there. But, my tooth is, like, I had two different people give me a second opinion. One of them I paid, like, over $120 to be told that, like, there was no chance of saving it, or it was very little chance. And so I did finally get it pulled, and, that's the long version of why you didn't see me play saxophone tonight, if that's what you were expecting. Because usually when I go to Overtime Tavern on Thursday night, I play saxophone. And I played mandolin. And I need a better amp. And I need a better mandolin. So this one's like a beginner one, I think. Maybe intermediate. But I'm too strong. I'm like pulling them out of the plastic fret. They're not anchored properly at the top. I need something to happen differently. And I'm not a luthier, so I don't know. But I do know that I could be getting a better sound. And I need it. So I enjoy playing my mandolin, and I like to play all sorts of different instruments, but I'm pretty shy about it. And I'm not a musician. Like, I don't consider that my thing. Like, I am a musician, but that's not... I'm a social worker that happens to play music. And now that I've been on medical leave for 3 years and been really poor, really poor for most of that time, I'm still waiting for my back pay. I have disability now, but I am paying $1,300 on a first and second home loan, a home that I own in Crestwell, Oregon, that I don't know who lives there now, but if they're paying rent, it's not going towards the mortgage. So, and I pay $300 for where I live, and so I'm paying $1,600 a month in rent. And, the home was behind in 2 months, and so it just stopped being paid in November. And so I got some retirement money, and I've been trying to work extra, but it's hard to find people who want to give me extra, like, you know, I can clean shit, and I can play music, and I can grow weed, and, like, so far none of those things have made me rich. So I sit and talk at my phone and hope somebody will eventually notice. And I think people are starting to. I've been homeless for 2.5 years. I've been in the same place for 6 months now, renting a place. But my family, I grew up like 7-8 miles away from here. I'm in Eugene, and I grew up in Crestwell and graduated in 88, and my family has millions of dollars, and they decided to get rid of me and all sorts of fun things. So, not really fun, but some of you have been following me and some of you wonder who the fuck I am and why am I coming on to talk to you now. But I know that there, in some circles people know who I am, but around here either people don't or they pretend like they don't, and so it's kind of confusing. So I was at the dentist for, like, I went there for a 3 o'clock appointment and I left at 5:45. And not that whole entire time was in the chair. They were a half hour late. And then, it took like 5 or 6 shots of Novocaine. And, like halfway through, I had to have a break because it just like hurt. And I kind of got panicked and, I was seeing bright lights and stuff, and so, like, they gave me a little break, but it was pretty painful, and so, I am out doing things I probably shouldn't really be. I should be sleeping now, but, I don't know. I'm just sad. Like, I can feel people realizing how much I've been fucked over, and my daughter's been kept from me since March of last year when I was, like, arrested for no real reason, and I wasn't actually even arrested, but they needed my fingerprints, and they needed some paperwork out of my car, and so I don't know exactly who they were. They were dressed in Springfield police, the ones that took me, but I don't know. So I was there for long enough to see if somebody's pregnant or not and get a positive test. So 11 days and then released. So I haven't seen my daughter since that time. That was in like the very last bit of March 31st. I haven't seen her since whatever the Wednesday was right before that. So, I just keep hoping that that will be better. It's my daughter Hannah. And she'll be 7 on the 21st. And I don't know where she is. I've been told she's with my family. So, and, she's, like, losing her benefits because it used to be able to be really easy to claim benefits with me because I was homeless, so whoever was getting benefits at my house, it looked like I was still there because that's the address I used, and now I have a different address, and I explained to people that her benefits were going to stop, and that I'd like to figure that out, and I don't know, I think there's been some repercussions, and I did my best to help ahead of time. I don't want people getting in trouble, but some of it's been misunderstanding. Like my WIC has been going to that address. Hey.
Can you help a guy out by any chance?
A what?
Can you help a guy out from Coeur d'Alene, Idaho by any chance?
What do you need?
I'm trying to rent a room at a hostel. My brother's in Medford.
Yeah.
I'm down here visiting, here for 5 days. I'm trying to come up with $15 to rent a cheap $30 room.
Yeah, I'm pretty poor myself, but yeah, I mean, I'm looking for ways to make money myself,
right,
yeah,
okay.
But keep trying, there's,
right.
You might bump into somebody,
I
that's,
feel
yeah, good luck. All right,
thank you.
It's hard to ask people for money, like, I didn't very well when I was, I was the kind of kid that was horrified when it was time to, I loved everything about being in the Brownies and the Girl Scouts, except when it came time to sell the cookies, because I have, like, really, really bad social anxiety, and asking strangers outside of the post office to buy cookies was not really my thing, and so doing it for something like, you know, gas money or stuff like that, like food, is not very nice either, and even being homeless for like 2.5 years of the last 3 years, most people didn't realize or didn't believe me. Like when I said I was living in my car, like I think they thought that I was traveling a lot or that, you know, I was spending a lot of time driving or something. And, that I was just like not drunk or not, you know, too messed up to drive when I was pulled over on the side of the road. I was, like, doing my best to find places to be safe. So, and it's not really good to be predictable, because that makes it easier for you to be targeted. It's like, I've been targeted a lot, and people just really, I've been labeled as being crazy. Like, my own family has told police that I'm crazy, and, so you just don't get it. Once you get labeled as mentally ill, the police don't listen to you. They just don't, they don't care. It's just like, you can say whatever the fuck you want. It's not gonna work. And I've literally had my rights, like, frozen since September of 2017, when I was accused of a Dewey for smoking marijuana 45 minutes before I drove. I was at a Starbucks, and I did so in the parking lot because that's where I lived, in my fucking car. And I went in and I checked some emails and did some paperwork and came back and was followed by a car labeled Cresswell Sheriff that pulled me over for a supposed light, not using my turn signal. This was on the way from Springfield to, I was going to Dexter the back way through Pleasant Hill, and this car said Cresswell on it, and they handcuffed me. They didn't read me my rights. They made me do the field sobriety test, and they said that they towed my car, but Mark Meyer came and got it and used it for the time, you know, used it for that until I was able to go get it. They did take it, so I had to pay and get it impound, you know, the impound fee and all that, but it didn't really go there. They just, you know, needed it for that night. And so they picked me up and drove me from outside of Pleasant Hill, Oregon, all the way to Eugene, where I then had another sobriety test that was videotaped, and then they did a urine test in the outhouse there. And then about 25 people were there, all male officers, like they were there for all male, like it was the beginning of a all male orgy, except they weren't even as good looking as those homely porn stars. And they put me in a little tiny room with two guys, two police officers that kept shining lights in my eyes, and they had me do a breathalyzer, and it came out 0.0, and they gave me a ride home where I was staying in Eugene. I was actually living in a tent guarding a grow room, and dropped me off like it was a date, and then I had to go pay however many hundreds of dollars to get my car out. And then my car broke down about 2 months later, and I left it at a car dealership in Eugene, and my credit cards got taken out of it, used out of it, and got used at the county a whole bunch of times for impounds and for diversion classes, and for, and then it started getting used for lots of alcohol, and like it was my business card, and so I wouldn't use it for any of those things. And it was like a card that had $10,000 limit, and it suddenly the balance was $16,000 on it, and I kept calling Chase and telling them that this was happening, and they wouldn't even close it or investigate it. And so I don't know exactly what's happened, but my life lately is getting credit reports and pouring through them for ways to possibly find anything that could help save me some money or make it so I don't have to pay $16,000 back or that kind of stuff. So I apologize if I haven't been coming on and telling you funny little stories and doing clever little bits, because I'm really fucking stressed, and I'm really good at looking like I feel okay about things, and I don't really feel okay about things. So, but I don't feel like just laying around, and I spend a lot of time by myself. So, and that's probably a good thing, I guess. Not really. It's not really. I don't have anybody, so all the people that I would have, I've tried to have them for the last 4 years, and nobody's been interested. So I don't know why that is. So usually I keep to myself, and it's like I'm pretty like low maintenance, and people don't usually pay attention to me very much. So that's always been fine with me. And when I get attention now, it's like not always, it's not the right type of attention. That's not like the thing I want. So I don't know. The type of attention I want, I don't know. I don't like tons of attention. I like the kind of attention like when you do something awesome in basketball and everybody cheers. I like that kind of attention. Thank you. I think I will go see what's happening around. It's Oregon, and there's like sad. I'm sad. I don't know if people are just, I don't want to be paranoid, or people are keeping it from me, or if it's just because I'm poor, but the weed that I have is, I never have good weed. I like to grow my own, and I haven't been able to in like 4 years, not to completion. And when I did that, people would come and just like take it. I didn't realize it at the time, but people really like my marijuana, and so instead of having me grow it, they pretend like I'm the one growing it, and then sell shit that I would never have anything to do with. That's really frustrating. I'd rather be in control of my own business and then assign people to do things for me. But my business isn't going as well as it could because I'm not really in charge. Until fairly recently, I have to like prove myself in court. Like they say, I'm too crazy to stand trial for a misdemeanor DUI from September 2017 so that they can seize my assets and take any instruments or any packages delivered to any of my residences and up my mailbox. They're getting away with transferring my business. Anything that comes to my business name, they transfer to a different location, and they transfer things to different locations, and it's kind of fucked up. I don't know if people think that that's my wish, or if they're all, everybody's just like, tee hee hee, that's really funny that we're getting this one over on her. I don't know what it is, but I feel the energy, and it's just, it's not very nice. It's not very nice at all. It takes a lot of energy to pretend like you don't know. So, and to just be patient, and to act like, you know, I don't know, it reminds me of just, like, how alcoholic families are. Like, you just have to, like, you know, somebody gets shit-faced, and they're really ridiculous, and they act in a way that embarrasses everybody, and then they're better the next day, and so everybody has to just be all better, and nobody talks about it, and it's just to have to move forward. And I went to school, like, for a lot of years to be a mental health therapist because I needed to figure some shit out. And I think every single mental health therapist goes there to figure shit out for themselves, and some are better at realizing that than others. And fortunately, hopefully, I didn't inflict that too much on other people. For the last 12 years of my career, I was a clinical supervisor, which is like a pretty high level of standard to be able to know how to conduct yourself professionally. But I got in trouble for medical marijuana. I became out, and I contracted with an agency that gave alcohol and drug treatment here in Eugene, and I was filmed at a Grateful Dead show, smoking marijuana and dancing and in Chicago and Santa Clara, and I don't know what else happened, but they ran me out within a month, and I went from having a contracted position at that place for like $8,000 to $12,000 a month from just them, to not having that at all, and not having any type of coverage. I didn't have disability insurance coverage, and I had to go on medical leave because at that time, coincidentally, I had like this really big, huge lapse where I remembered like severe trauma from my childhood. And I was being drugged, and I don't want to go into tons of details because it makes me sound like some sort of schizophrenic, paranoid weirdo when I'm not. But I know I was being drugged, and people may have even been told that it was actual medicine that I wanted, like that it was marijuana, and it was not. And there was some pretty significant hallucinogens and methamphetamine and all sorts of stuff, and it fucked me up for a while. Like, this was in 2015. I lost 80 pounds in 5 months, because I would do things like go hiking 3 times a day up and down Spencer Butte, and which is a little mountain here, and I would like drive for a couple of days, and day and night, and I was getting out and wandering places, and my neighbor happens to be a police officer, and we grew up together. He was 4 years younger than me and took my sister to the prom, and he's apparently sheriff. I don't know how he could still be sheriff now, but of our county. And I wandered into his yard once and said that I was looking for a ride to a party, and so he called I was totally like just spaced out, and so he called armed officers to come and handcuff me and put me in the back of their cruiser, and they took me to the university district here in Eugene from Cresswell, drove me all the way in, and one of the officers used a key to go into the back door at the hospital and set me in a room. They put me in like scrubs and watched me until I got bored and left. So that's how the sheriff here is informed on dealing with people with post-traumatic stress disorder, is just to call your friends to come and handcuff her and take her in. So I don't really know how this guy is still, like, I don't know how he hasn't been arrested for things like this, let alone if he really is. I mean, I've had some hope that maybe people are playing a joke on me, and there's no way Cliff Harold could be a sheriff. But if that really is the case, he has authorized a lot of really poor, improper treatment of somebody like me, a mental health therapist with a lot of years of experience, like, you know, wandering into somebody's yard doesn't require police to come and pick you up and handcuff you. That's a huge violation of human rights, and this fucker is getting away with things. He has been able to deal methamphetamine because he's buddies with Mark Meyer, who cooks it, and also funded by Mr. Obama, who's really been... He released so many meth addicts and cooks, and he brought them here to Oregon. He paid for them to move here. He pardoned them personally. If you look it up, he let out record numbers of people during his administration that were involved in methamphetamine, like he was picking them, hand-picking them, letting them out, and bringing them as a crew. And he set them up, and he got them into housing, and he set a huge racket up, and it got too big for him, and now he can't keep up with it. And when your plan, your budget plan, is taking whatever cash you have and getting to Las Vegas, the cheapest way to put that down on a pony, to see what you'll have to spend the next day, it just really doesn't work very well. And so it's kind of like, it came with good funding and with my ideas, and it was a whole bunch of ideas about how to use marijuana to further all sorts of, I outlined all sorts of things. This was during the time period when a lot of things were going on for me, so I had a lot of ideas, and instead of having marijuana grows, they acted like they were marijuana grows, but they were undercover meth cooks, and they managed to cook openly in a couple of stores and different places, and it's the whole, I don't know exactly who it is. It's like I said, Obama's been huge in it, and if you ask around here, he funds a lot of things, and he's the silent partner in a lot of things, and he's on a board of directors, and he gives all sorts of money, so he's got a lot of shit going on. That why would this dude from Chicago and DC want to come to Eugene, Oregon, where he, like, you know, there's a noticeable increase in, there's not very many black people around here, and I know that he's not, like, maybe your classic black guy, he's, like, kind of the white guy who looks black, but still, like, what, he's wearing Carhartt, and he is, you know, smoking crack out in the parking lot, and he's done run out of cash and hookers. So whatever plan it was for them tweakers to take over, it hasn't worked very well. They had at one point, when things were going really well, they were using stolen credit cards to purchase the ingredients for methamphetamine cooks, and to deliver them to sites where they were being cooked, of houses that were donated for somebody to stay, and instead of having that person stay there, they used it to cook methamphetamine, or they used it to whatever the purpose was. So all of that stuff was working really nicely for people until funding, actually, they can't get into a certain bank account anymore, and they've run out of people to send in to say that they're beneficiaries, that they're rep payees, or that they're girlfriends or boyfriends, or who knows what the fuck. So, so that's just the way it is. I've been screwed over with duck tickets and stuff like that. Like, people have chosen a handful of duck tickets to go see football over me being nice to me. Like, it's just kind of like, oh, okay, we're good. Hand cash, whatever it takes. Like, somebody wants to help me out. Well, suddenly they're flying off to Orlando. You know, that kind of stuff. So, and I did post some things. I don't know. It's probably blocked, but Jeff Sessions is personally funding law enforcement here and sending checks with his signature on it to Eugene, Springfield, and Lane County sheriffs, and even some Oregon State Police officers, as some new federal program. I'm not exactly sure how he's justifying the program, but he is making sure that they have just who they need to track down Don Sly. So it's been really interesting. I don't think so. There's some really yucky guys. A couple were nice, but men, if you're listening to me, I might have your attention. Stroking the air like you're rubbing your penises and then spraying out doesn't impress women at all. In fact, that makes us kind of feel sad for you, and it's reminding some of us why we're not with you. But that's just me, because I'm a lesbian. I don't... That is the whole point. So it just kind of highlights that. But I don't know. There might be a certain group of people that that attracts. And if so, maybe you all need some shirts for it or something. I don't know. Because it could rule the rest of us out. So... It's 1 a.m. here, Pacific Standard Time, in Eugene, Oregon. I'm recalling trauma as gently as I can so it doesn't further induce more trauma. I'm not the only one that's happened to. It's gotten pretty, there's a lot of dead bodies around Eugene lately. You watch the news and read about it. No. They need to move along. Hey. I'm doing good. How's it going? I am having real good fun. It's almost time to go dancing. Yes, I'm Uber Dyke, so if you have packages labeled to Uber Dyke, that's me. I'm Sparkle Baby. I'm Sly 122. I'm the Obama girl. A few of those are my names. Dot. Dawn Sly. Sometimes it's D-O-N, but it's supposed to be D-A-W-N, like the crack of. Or sometimes I like to say my name is Dawn. Because I come in the morning. Only thing that can make my name better is to have my middle name be Twilight, so I can come twice a day. Yes, this should hurt, but I will heal faster than anybody else, guaranteed. That was one of the nastiest tooth pulls that he had. I think I was supposed to go to have actual surgery, to be knocked out, oral surgery. So I got the $90 yank-a-doodle. My friends moved alone. I'll heal even faster if I get real marijuana. 104.7. It's not Indiana. It's not like all Harold and Kumar up in here. It's Oregon. I should just drive up and have people hand free marijuana to me outside. From the outside. But that's just my opinion. Uh-huh. oh, and you say, move for me, move for me, move for me. The counter signature on Jeff Sessions checks as Rudy Giuliani. That's probably what people would find the most interesting, because it's gonna get some people in some really, really big trouble really fast. Criminal trouble, even. You could if you feel like that. Maybe I've set it up on your phone for you. And then I'd be crazy like I have some sort of special powers. I'm sorry, I forgot to add you to the list the other day, Ariana. It wasn't intentional. I sang to her, I guess, when I played some Mario Kart or something. Mm. This is what I do. If I get a family back, I promise I can still do this. This is what entertains you. It can still happen. I'll prioritize my time. I'm disappointed that Eugene doesn't have a place where you can go and play music and smoke or what a, like, you know, have a private club or a place in public, not just like a place to go hang out. Well, if I had my house, that could be a place, but that will be soon. Cold out, but the less items to take in, the fewer things to touch the surface of a bar, the better. Alright, so take one layer off. I caught my fleece on fire today. Just the hazard of being a stoner. It just is. Maybe we need like little shields here or something. Something to protect the fleece from fire. It's not exciting now because I'm just a real person and I'm putting on my fucking jacket. Can't entertain all the time. Maybe not at all. I would like to tell a story, but I'm just not in the right space yet. But we'll go see what's happening out there. Today. It's beautiful. Well, I left my saxophone at home. If anybody has been touching my saxophone, it's without my permission. People think that sometimes they think that my saxophone is, that I don't really play saxophone because the way that my saxophone is set up is not for regular people. So it takes a lot of power to breathe, to blow into it. And I usually have it on a number four reed, which is, most people don't use that either. So, it's kind of a tricky thing. Anybody be running around with my saxophone, that means they went to Walter's house and got it without my permission. Or there's a set, there's a real one and a fake one, and maybe they bought my real one. That would be nice. Because I'm looking for my real one. I don't have my real one right now.
You gotta fucking say it like that.
Not on the bed, baby, on your sofa. Fuck the booty, come on, leave the table, chop, chop. You do what you don't know, you're gonna win, chop.